John 16:25, turn in your Bible, please. Recently, I've been doing some self-reflection on how I use my time. It's good to do that every once in a while, to do a check-in with yourself and go, how am I using the blocks of time that I have in my week? And so I've been doing that, and I was reminded of a book that I read a couple years ago called 12 Ways Your Phone is Changing You. How about that for a book title? 12 Ways Your Phone is Changing You by Tony Rinke. I could be butchering his last name, but it's 12 Ways Your Phone is Changing You. In the book, he talks about what is called Satan's nothing strategy, and that strategy that he uses us to pull us constantly into doing things that we're not particularly excited to do, but we find ourselves just in the drudgery of doing them, of, in this case, a random slot machine of a viral content. That's what our phone can turn into. And he describes himself in the book of an encounter that he had with his phone. And I just want to read it to you. And an excerpt from the book. And maybe, don't raise your hand, this describes you. I plead guilty, it's described me at certain points. He says this. He goes, today after work, I open Facebook on my phone and I look for a diversion. I flick past a couple of videos that sounded, of a cat that sounded like a crying child. And then I saw a new study about gun control. And then I saw an innovative new keyboard for tablets. And then I read a story from the latest celebrity gossip. Then I was offered 20 pictures of actors who have aged badly, which of course I ignored. And then I saw a breaking news story about a rogue militia group in Oregon. Then I read that North Korea apparently had detonated a test atomic bomb. And then I watched a viral video of a monster shredder that crushes refrigerators, couches, and cars with large metal teeth. And then I saw pictures of a friend and his wife on vacation in Iceland. On and on, I flicked down a list of disconnected and fragmented items, and most of them only barely important or interesting. I was not edified or saved or served. Definitely not saved. Not served. Only further fatigued because I missed a nap that I should have taken or a walk I could have gone on, and I was easily lured back to my phone for more. And then I remembered I skipped my personal disciplines this morning. My battle against all the slothful smartphone tendencies I see in my heart has only just begun. Convicting? Yep. Here's what he then describes, the spiritual aspect of this. Hear this. He goes, here's what I'm coming to understand. It's that this impulse to pull the lever of the random slot machine of viral content, it's an age-old tactic, trick of Satan. C.S. Lewis called it the nothing strategy in his Screwtape letters. It is the strategy that eventually leaves a man at the end of his life looking back in lament. I now see that I spent most of my life in doing neither what I ought nor what I liked. This nothing strategy is very strong, strong enough to steal away a man's best years, not in sweet sins, but in dreary flickering of the mind, over it knows not what and knows not why, in the gratification of curiosity so feeble that man is only half aware of them. And so I've been thinking about myself as I was reminded of these words, and I was thinking, okay, how am I using my own time? How do I use my phone? How do I use social media? Things like that. And for you, maybe it's cat videos. That's what does it for you. But for me, it's probably news. There's that FOMO, fear of missing out, of wanting to know the most recent thing that's happening. That's where I plead guilty. And as I was thinking about that, I began to think even further, what does the mass ingestion of all news and all other content that's available to us, what does that do to our soul over time? One last statement from Rinke. He says, yes, to have a smartphone is amazing, but to have the internet on our phones is also to have immediate access to all the world's major tragedies, sorrows, bombings, and acts of terrorism. Here's the question. Are we prepared to carry this burden? Friends, I don't think it's too far-fetched to see a correlation between an uptick in depression with an uptick in having, in 5 seconds, all of the world's problems in front of you. Like, this is so unprecedented. You realize that we're only about still, okay, I can remember when my dad had a pager, so I remember when the phone came in, and I remember the iPhone, that was late 2000s. Do you realize how short of a time that we're in? That for all of human history, most things that people knew were local, and now it's international at your fingertips. What does it do to your soul to have all of that at your disposal? Hear me in asking the question. I'm not saying that you shouldn't be informed. I'm asking, should we think more deeply in how we make sure that we're informed? Perhaps we need to reevaluate our priorities. Perhaps we need less talking heads, self-help gurus, social media influencers, just all the noise. If you're a Christian, you can probably figure out real quickly where I'm going here. What's the pivot? What do we need? We need Christ. We need his word. And you know that's the right church answer, but I want to ask you, at bottom, based on how you act, do you really believe that? Do you really believe that at bottom, what you need in place of all the noise is to hear Christ and his word? I think my hope is by the end of this morning that you're going to see even more so that the answer to that question is always a resounding yes. But you would see in particular that it's important to hear Christ and his word because of the victory that comes in the midst of all of the tragedies that are in front of us that we can have at our fingertips. I want to read out of John 16:33. Jesus says this. This is where we're going to end this morning. So I'm going to read here and then we'll back up. John 16:33 says this. I have said these things to you, Jesus says, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Let me pray. Lord Jesus, this morning, in the midst of all of the noise, all of the sin that we see out there, and then yet all of the sin that we see in our own heart, Lord, how is Jesus victorious? We want to know that. We want to see you. We want to see ourselves in light of who you are, Lord. We want to know the truth. We want to know what it means to be loved by the Father. We want to get the things that we've been talking about for the last 9 weeks. We want to not just cognitively get them, but they'd be so real, it changes what we do as we walk out from here. Lord, let our right beliefs transform us, so that we would be true Christians that act based on what you have said to us. Lord, let the word cut through the noise for us this morning, for so many of us. I'm asking you to do something, Lord, that I can't do. I'm asking for your spirit to move in this place. So Holy Spirit, convict us of sin, righteousness, and judgment, and bring us to Jesus. That's what we ask. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. I want to tell you, every single week when we get into the farewell discourse, that's what we've been in since the beginning of this year, there can kind of be a sense when you hop into it on a Sunday morning, it feels like we're kind of parachuting down into the middle of a text. So let me help us get our bearings real quick as we move forward. We have heard for the last 3 chapters Jesus speaking to his disciples, and now we're at the end of what we would call the farewell discourse. We're at what's called the epilogue. That's what you would call it if you're using terms from literature. And then next week, if you look, John 17, it's the famous high priestly prayer. And so here's where we're at. Jesus is wrapping up what he's saying, and as he wraps it up, the dominoes are going to start to fall. He finishes speaking. Judas is going to show up and betray him. The disciples are going to flee, and it's going to lead to him being crucified on the cross and resurrected from the dead on the third day. That's how the story is going to go. And so what we have in front of us right here is a summary of everything that Jesus has just said. So congratulations. If you haven't been to church at all this year, you picked the right Sunday to be here. We're summing it all up. So here we go, okay? Verse 25, I have said these things to you, Jesus says, in figures of speech. Figures of speech. Hold on to that. We're coming back to that. The hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures of speech, but I will tell you plainly about the Father. In that day, you will ask in my name, and I do not say that I will ask the Father on your behalf. For the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. I came from the Father, and I've come into the world. And now I'm leaving the world, and I'm going to the Father. And so Jesus now points us to those big realities, those two big words we've been hitting on every single week, that word truth and the love of the Father. Okay, let's take both in turn. First, truth, and then the love of the Father. This is what Jesus gives us access to. And there's a clarity that comes with this truth. And it's a clarity that comes from the Spirit. I want to reread again. Jesus says, I have said these things to you in figures of speech. Now, when you read that, you might think maybe parables. But what's different about John's gospel in comparison to the other gospels is that you're not going to get that many parables, really, if any, in John's gospel. You're going to get a lot more imagery of light and darkness. You're going to get that imagery of light and darkness, of what is true and what is false. Different kinds of imagery, but you're not going to get parables. What is he talking about here? I think the best way to understand this is with D.A. Carson, who says, this isn't parables that Jesus is saying, that's what I've been speaking to you in, but it's more the obscurity of his utterances. The disciples have been listening to all of this. He's not speaking unclearly, but something is missing from his lips to their ears. There is a fog. And so when is that fog going to be lifted? Jesus says, there's coming a moment where I will speak with that clarity. And if you have been reading, you know that that clarity comes when the Spirit arrives, the one who will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak and he will declare to you. He will take what is mine, he's going to declare it to you. And so Jesus says, there's coming a moment where things are going to get clear. We know from a few weeks ago, it's the Spirit who's going to make that clear. And you and I, Lord willing, as we've been going through these passages together, there's a clarity that comes from being on the other side of the resurrection. The disciples hadn't gotten there yet. And so for them, they had not fully understood. Everything is cloudy. They need the Spirit. With me? Okay. And so I want to ask you this question. Last week, assuming that you got into God's word, Lord willing, if you know that the Spirit is necessary for you to have clarity of the truth of Jesus, which is this book, did you stop for a moment when you began to read this book and go, all right, Holy Spirit, I can't get into this book by myself. I need your help. There's something that happened when I was in graduate school. I can't remember if I've said this before, but here it is again. Where the Bible became something like my textbook because I needed to understand it rightly so that I could pass a test. And the Bible can kind of become that way for us if we're just going through the motions of reading the book. But if we're not asking, Spirit of the living God, keep the Spirit together with the truth of God's word so that I can get it, you will not be transformed. And I'm thinking about how this last Wednesday and the Wednesdays that I've been in prayer meetings before, about how I've been blessed to be with those who are a little bit older than me. And there's something that happens when you begin to pray for repentance. And as you're praying for repentance, Lord, transform me. Show me where I'm wrong. Lord, convict our church. And you're praying for those things. And I can think of the words of some of our saints, some who are 70 and even 80 years old and older, that are saying, Lord, I repent of, change me. Lord, begin to work on my heart. And you know what that does for someone who's younger to hear those kinds of words? First of all, it's like, whoa, I got a long way to go. That's the first thing. I think the second thing is, you are never too old to go before the Lord and say, Lord, show me what I cannot see by just reading this book. Lord, show me what I can only see when the Spirit works through me as I read this book. Only the Spirit brings that kind of transformation where you can have that soft heart leading towards repentance all throughout your life. And that's what I want for us, is that we acknowledge the Spirit who gives us clarity as we come before God's word. I think the second thing too is that we consider the source. There are so many, I don't know if you know this, there are so many voices on social media that claim to speak for God and claim to speak about God and yet are completely godless. I would ask you to consider this. The next time you get on social media, you get on online, consider whether the source is full of the Spirit. Here's one way you can really tell. It's actually not too difficult. Time and time again, I have found in my life that when I encounter someone who I don't know, after about a few minutes of getting to know them, I usually go, $5, that person's a Christian. $5 at least. And the reason I can do that is because the same Spirit that's in me is the one that's in them as well. Like recognizes like. And so as you're listening and hearing voices that are out there, ask the question, is this person actually even a Christian? I'll be specific. Just because Joe Rogan told you, just because Jordan Peterson told you, just because Andrew Tate told you, some of you who are older may not know these names, but if you're younger, you know exactly what I'm talking about right now. And I see you smirking. Just because they said it doesn't make it true. You go to God's word and you hear from the Holy Spirit, who will speak what has been true and that Christians have heard for thousands of years, and they've staked their lives upon it. Listen to those who speak from the Spirit that lead to the truth. That's the first thing, Spirit of truth. Second, Jesus gives us the love of the Father. The love of the Father. Verse 26, in that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say that you will, and I do not say to you that I will ask the Father on your behalf. For the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. So not only do we have the Spirit that leads us to truth that's coming, but we also have access to the love of the Father. And so since I'm just being specific here, let me go even more. You have direct access to the Father in Jesus' name, so you don't need to pray to saints. You don't need to pray to the Virgin Mary. You don't need to pray to a lost one, loved one who may have gone before you. You don't need to pray to angels. You don't need to be like those in the Old Testament who went before a priest and said, here's my sacrifice. If you made it through the book of Leviticus, blessings to you, right? In your reading plan, if you've been with us so far this year. But as you've been reading that, congratulations. You don't have to do any of those things because you have the book of Hebrews, which tells you that there is a great high priest that is the fulfillment of all of those things. You don't need to go to an Old Testament high priest, and you don't need a Roman Catholic priest to be your mediator between God and man. We have the high priest who bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness, and by his wounds we have been healed. Christ alone has torn the veil, not bottom up, but the veil top to bottom in the temple, only from God's perspective, downward. And he rent it in two so that you would be able to have access to your Father that your sin kept you from. We know this to be true if we are Christians, that we have that kind of access. Thank Jesus that you don't have to make that access for yourself. He has made it possible. And it's not just love. It is the love of the Father. It is love from a father. How tragic it is to see good people spend portions of their life, not just months, but years and decades, trying to win the approval of someone they will never have, who might even be dead. I've heard too many personal accounts of people telling me they can remember once or twice when their father told them that they loved them or that they had done a good job. And typically in these stories, it's been Aaron's experience here, what I have seen, friends, is that those people can remember where they were, how it was said, the circumstance it was said in which they heard their father say, good job, or I love you. And the reason it stuck out so much to them was because it was so rare. That's the one point they could point it to. And as just an aside, you can never tell your kids you love them too much. You can never do that. And yet for so many, that hasn't been the case. And because of that neglect or abuse, they're forced to reckon with that rejection and abdication of parental responsibilities that lead to finding or seeking that approval in other areas, whether that is in other people or whether that is in vices, it could even be in success, and so on. Their parent could be dead and they're still trying to win their approval. and subconsciously they don't even realize that they're doing it. And I think this perhaps, I'm confident because we're sinners, that describes a number of us in the room. And I want you to know that this morning, there is good news, that you will never have to win the approval of your heavenly Father, despite what your earthly father may have done. And you know that you have the approval of your heavenly Father in this room today, because he has demonstrated his love by the sending of his Son. John 3:16, right? We've been pointing back to this constantly, that for God so loved the world, how? By the sending of his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Even if your own parent messed up, the Heavenly Father never messes it up, and he gives us the Son. And so if you want to put everything we've been saying, this is a day of summary, put everything we've been saying about the love of the Father, here's how it works. The Father loves you, and so he sends the Son. And so the Son, when you look at him and you see the Son, you see the love of the Father. And when you believe in the Son and he transforms you by the Spirit, you then reciprocate that love to the Father. And you love the Lord your God with all of your heart, soul, and mind. And then you can love your neighbor as yourself. From the Father, through the Son, made possible in you by the Holy Spirit, so you can have true divine love in which you love those the way Christ has loved you from the Father. That's how it works. Verse 28, see this. That's love, and we've been given clarity of the truth from the Spirit. Jesus then does something here that I love. If you were going to underline one verse in the entire book of John, I would underline this one, and here's why. It sums up the whole book. Watch. I came from the Father, Jesus says. I have come into the world, and now I am leaving the world and going to the Father. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. He has fulfilled his mission by going to the cross, demonstrating his Father's love for you, and he is going back to the Father. And by the way, when we finish the farewell discourse, we're going to go through the rest of John 18 through 21, and we'll call that the return to the Father. Because that's exactly what Jesus does, and we'll make it in time for Easter. That's what we're doing, to give you a heads up on what's happening. And so if Jesus has made all of this possible by his resurrection, for the last time, the disciples then begin to speak. And the disciples have served something as a foil, as Jesus is speaking the truth, and they're kind of the ones over the side like, we don't get it, we don't know it, and they respond back, and Jesus has to bring clarity. And for the last time they speak, and this is what they say, verse 29, his disciples said, ah, now we know you are speaking plainly and not just using figurative speech. Now we know that you know all things and do not need anyone to question you. This is why we believe that you came from God. And Jesus answered them, oh, do you believe? Behold, the hour is coming, indeed it has come, when you will be scattered, each to his own home, and you'll leave me alone. Yet I am not alone, for the Father is with me. I have said these things to you that you may have peace. In this world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world. That we read a little while ago. These are powerful words, friends. Please, I ask that you hear this, that compare who Jesus is to who we are. So let's behold what man has to offer, and then let's behold what Jesus in comparison offers. The disciples say, ah, now you're speaking plainly. And that should strike you for this reason. Jesus just got done saying, it's not going to be clear until after I've resurrected from the dead. And these guys are saying, these jokers are saying, way before that happens, they're saying, oh, now we understand you clearly. And so I want to correct something that I said last week. Last week I said, this is where the disciples finally get it. And I want to confess to you that I was far too overly optimistic. They absolutely don't get it. And so when Jesus says that hour is coming, and then they jump the gun, and they think, now we know. They're claiming to know something that hasn't been brought with clarity from the Spirit. Carson again puts it this way. This just hurts. No misunderstanding is more pathetic than that which thinks it no longer exists. No misunderstanding is more pathetic than that which thinks it no longer exists. And so the only thing that they're offering is complete and utter ignorance. That's what man offers. And so I think it convicts us again to see this reality. Proximity to the things of Christ does not necessarily equal a legitimacy of faith. Just because you're close to Jesus doesn't mean you get it. Judas was with Jesus 3 years. These disciples were with him for 3 years, and they're still lost, and they still don't understand it. And for those of us who think we understand better than the disciples, I'd ask you to consider that the devil has better theology than you do. That he knows his Bible better than you do. He knows how to quote it better than you do. He's been around a lot longer than you and I have. And so the devil has better theology, knows has better biblical doctrine than you and I do. And yet the devil will end up in the lake of fire when all of this is said and done. So clearly, right intellectual understanding isn't enough. Well, what about right action? Jesus says elsewhere, and let this not be us. To the person who says, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do mighty works in your name? Jesus will say, I never knew you. Depart from me, you workers of lawlessness. Iniquity, if you've got the old King James. And so proximity to the things of Christ, rightly knowing the things of Christ, and even acting and claiming to do Christian things are not enough if you do not have the Spirit who transforms you. Man, apart from the Spirit of Christ, can so delude and think and deceive himself into thinking he is fine when in reality he is not. And I've said this before and I will say this again to some of us in this room. In a room this size, there are those of us who are saved. There are those of us who know we're not saved. You're here somewhere. I don't know who you are, but you're here. You're not saved. And there are those of us who think that we're saved and we're not. And that's the group that I continue to be convicted about week in and week out when I preach. It's to think that there are those of us who think we are good and we're actually not. And you're the kind of person perhaps who have so deceived yourself into thinking that you are. And in reality, all you have done is figure out how to cloak your wickedness with Christian terminology. And your family suffers because of it. And God is not honored. And it will be you at Judgment Day, if that is you, who will have no excuse above all other people because you heard God's word week in and week out, and yet you never let the Spirit come into your life to bring transformation that only he could do. You must have the Spirit, otherwise your works are worthless and your right understanding is worthless. And my heart breaks for you because that is exactly what I was. I was a young, lost theologian on his way to hell. I want that for you. I want you to move from being a counterfeit. I want you to move to being someone who experiences that transformation. You may not even be a young person. You may be an older person who has led the Christian life, so-called, but Spirit hasn't come in. And so without the Spirit, the disciples are ignorant. And I want you to be able to say, as the disciples could say afterwards, that you could say one day with humility, only the Spirit has brought transformation in my life. Now the light's turned on. That's my prayer for you. So that's the first thing. The first thing that they don't get is that they have complete and utter ignorance. The second thing that man offers is he has a faithlessness or a counterfeit faithfulness that leads to betrayal. Let me show you what I mean. Jesus responds to these guys after they think they've got it all figured out. And he says, do you now believe? You should read that as like Jesus going, really? You think you got it figured out now? Here's what's going to happen 5 minutes from now. All of you are going to walk out from me, walk out on me. And so the faith that you think you have is going to demonstrate itself in leaving. Maybe you're that guy that's like, well, what about John? What about John? Wasn't he at the cross? Wasn't John at the cross? And he was faithful to the end? Again, I turned to one of the commentators who pointed out the difference between John in that moment and the John who had the Spirit breathe on him later is that John, if he was really following Christ, would have been up on that cross with his Savior, and yet he wasn't. He was just someone who was loitering around at Golgotha. He was not suffering with his Savior. He would later, but not yet. This is the part that's been hitting me all week, friends, as I've been looking at this. Jesus knows that all of these guys are going to walk out on him and betray him, and yet he has decided to give this farewell discourse anyways. I want to ask you in this room, if you were going to invest into someone and you had the foresight to know that they would betray you, abandon you, or not follow through, would you invest into them? Would you invest knowing that it wasn't going to work out? Would you do that anyways? Would you do that? Jesus does. He invests into people who will betray him. And he patiently has called you and me to obedience. Think of this last Sunday. You heard God's word last Sunday. You've heard it for weeks, years potentially for many of us. And yet, something last week for each of us, we have fallen into sin. And yet God has been so patient to endure with us who abandon him each time he calls us to obey. What kind of God is that who calls us to obedience, knows that we won't follow through, and yet still remains with us? That's who he is. He endures with us, whether we're faithful or not. And even though you may abandon him, God's word says that he will not abandon you. So despite what you may have done this last week, he hadn't gone anywhere. Because if you have called on the name of Jesus, the Spirit, who is the seal of Christ, will never leave you. So this is what man offers. Abandons the Lord, doesn't get it, but here's what Jesus offers. Behold him now. He says, I have said these things to you that you may have peace. What kind of man at the hour of his betrayal offers you peace? What kind of person does something like that? Where he ought to be the one who's getting counseled. He ought to be the one where people put in their arms around him saying it's going to be okay. And yet, in that moment, everybody's falling away, and he gives peace instead. And so if your sin shames you, know that God should give you judgment. Instead, he gives you the exact opposite of what you deserve. He gives you that peace. I'm the kind of guy that I love seeing pictures, friends, of the gospel anywhere I can. I try to see it in my own home. I try to see it whether I watch a movie or anything like that. One day, if you ever get a chance to go to London, you should go to the Queen's Theater. Justine and I had a chance to go there a few years ago. And if you get a chance to go to the Queen's Theater, you have to make sure that you see the musical Les Mis. And it knocks out of the park any of the movies that have been made about it. If you've seen the movies from 2012 or the one 1998 with Liam Neeson. But in that story, if you don't know the story, it's set in revolutionary France in the early part of the 19th century. And it's a story about Jean Valjean. And he is a peasant who steals some bread. And he steals some bread for his niece. And he is put in prison for 19 years for it. When he gets out of prison, he's obviously a changed man. He is much different than who he was when he went in. And he has absolutely nothing. And now he's a criminal as well. And so as he's trying to make ends meet, he comes across this bishop, and the bishop takes him in, actually calls him his honored guest, and gives him all of the resources that he needs. He feeds him, and it's an incredible account. But that night, everybody goes to bed, and this is what happens.
Is anybody there? So we'll use wooden spoons. I don't want to hear anything more about it.
I'm sorry to disturb you.
You caught him.
But I had my eye on this man.
Oh, thank God. I'm very angry with you, Jean Valjean.
What happened to your eye, Monseigneur?
Didn't he tell you he was our guest last night?
Oh, yes. After we searched his knapsack and found all this silver, he claimed that you gave it to him.
Yes. Of course I gave him the silverware. But why didn't you take the candlesticks? That was very foolish. Madame Gillot, fetch the silver candlesticks. They're worth at least 2,000 francs. Why did you leave them? Hurry. Monsieur Valjean has to get going. He's lost a lot of time. Did you forget to take them?
Are you saying he told us the truth?
Of course. Thank you for bringing him back. I'm very relieved.
Release him.
You're really letting me go?
Didn't you understand the bishop?
Madame Gillot, offer these men some wine. They must be thirsty.
Thank you.
And don't forget. Don't ever forget. You've promised to become a new man.
Promise? Why are you doing this?
Jean Valjean, my brother, you no longer belong to evil. With this silver, I've bought your soul. I've ransomed you from fear and hatred. And now I give you back to God.
Hear those words again. Jean Valjean, my brother, you no longer belong to evil. With this silver, I've bought your soul. I've ransomed you from fear and hatred, and now I give you back to God. We betray a God who knows that we will anyways, and yet he still does not walk out on us. To our salvation, the only thing that we offer is our sin. And in return, he offers us his son. We offer betrayal, and in return, he offers us the richness that comes with salvation. That's grace. That's what it's all about. And Jesus ends with those words, "Take heart, I have overcome the world." Many of us know this passage, but did he ever consider the timing of when Jesus said what he said? He said it not after he had been on the cross and resurrected. He said it before he went on the cross. This is who your God is. He is the kind of God that can declare the victory beforehand because he is the orchestrator of all human history, and he knows what will happen in the end. The conclusion of the story is certain. And so look at yourself, friend. Dear friend, and look at your own life. Look what lies ahead. And look at the confidence that you can have that though you may not know how it works out, in Christ you have the one who could look at death itself and say, it's already defeated before there was even an empty tomb. And so as we see the brokenness of this world, it's right there on our fingertips, as we see the sin that is out there and the sin that lives in our own heart, let's look once again and reorient ourselves to the word that matters the most, the word embodied in the person of Christ, whom the devil has no claim on, and if you're in him, the devil has no claim on you, and the one who is victorious. And if you are in him, you can look at all that lies in front of you, starting with your sin and death. And because you are found in Christ this morning, you too can be an overcomer. Let's pray.